Well, good morning, church family. Welcome to the Facebook Live and also welcome to the radio. We want to extend a special welcome to those of you who may be joining us from across the city or the state or maybe even the world. We are glad and grateful to be able to join with you in this way this morning. I want to point out just a couple of things that might be a little different this morning. You'll notice behind me on the screen, there's going to be some lyrics that are going to pop up as Pastor Bob is leading us in worship. And so we're trying to make this as simple and as easy as we can for you to join with us in worship as we go. Now, if you can't read the lyrics behind us, we want to share with you, for those on the radio and for those who are joining us on Facebook, we want to share with you the songs that we'll be worshiping with this morning. We'll be beginning with Fairest Lord Jesus, and then we will be worshiping with the song At Calvary. Then we'll move to Jesus Messiah. Fourth, we'll be worshiping with Christ, our hope in life and death. And then we will close out our service with Amazing Grace. So if for whatever reason you can't read the lyrics behind us, just Google those or maybe you have a hymnal at home and look them up in your hymnal. We want you to join with us as we worship. Let me read to you this morning from Psalm 27. I want to read verses 13 and 14, and then we'll pray together and begin our morning. Psalm 27, 13 and 14 says this: I believe that I shall look upon the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord, be strong, and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord. Pray with me. Father, we are so grateful for the day. We are so grateful to be able to join together, that we are maybe separated physically, but in this hour, we're joined together. Lord, thank you that no matter what happens in this life, we are never separated from you, that we are never separated from your goodness and your love. And God, I pray that this week, as we face the challenges that this week will bring, I pray, God, you would remind us of these verses, that we would wait for you, the Lord, that we would wait for the one who gives us help, wait for the one who gives us strength. God, I pray that for the next hour or so that you would help us to worship you. And God, I pray that as we approach this time of worship, that if we have sin in our hearts and sin in our life that we have yet to confess to you, God, would you convict us of that? And would you help us to confess that? And would you help us to worship you with clean hands, with a pure heart? God, help us to do that. Help us, Lord, to worship you as a family this morning. We thank you, we praise you, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning, everybody. I do want to encourage you to worship with us where you are and to sing along. And as Brother Brian said, you can Google the words on the internet. And if you're on the church email list, you should have received an email with the lyrics in a file. If you'd like to receive that, you're not on the church email list, just call the church or email the church, and we'll be sure to put you on that list as well. But we're going to start this morning by singing a great, great old hymn, Fairest Lord Jesus.
Fairest Lord Jesus, ruler of all nature, O thou of God and man the Son, thee will I cherish, thee will I honor, thou my soul's glory, joy, and breaks the woeful heart to sing. Fair is the sunshine, fairer still the moonlight, and all the twinkling starry host. Jesus shines brighter, Jesus shines purer than all the angels heaven can boast. Beautiful Savior, Lord of the nations, Son of God and Son of Man, glory and honor, praise and adoration, now and forevermore be thine.
Now sing that old familiar hymn. Years I spend in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me he died on Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. By God's word at last my sin I learned, then I trembled at the law I'd spurned, till my guilty soul imploring turned to Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Now I've given to Jesus everything, now I gladly own him as my King. Now my raptured soul can only sing of Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan, oh, the grace that brought it down to man, oh, the mighty gulf that God did span at Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Amen.
If you have your Bibles, let me encourage you to open them to Philippians chapter 2. And if you don't have your Bibles, go grab them so you can open them to Philippians chapter 2. We will be reading verse 1 through 11. God's word this morning says this: so if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but he emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him. And listen to this. He has bestowed on him the name that is above every name. So at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Well, this next worship song is a great song to follow that passage up with. A great song entitled Jesus Messiah. And then we're going to do a new song right after this.
He became sin who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, the name above all names. Blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. His body the bread, his blood the wine, broken and poured out all for love. The whole earth trembled and the veil was torn. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, the name above all names. Blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all our hope is in you. All our hope is in you. All the glory to you, God, the light of the Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. Jesus Messiah, Lord of all.
Well, in these difficult days that we're living in, we all need a word of hope, don't we? And it's good to know, wonderful to know that as believers in Christ, we have a sure hope. Our hope is in the Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ. Mindful of the old hymn that says, on Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is shifting sand, and that's true, isn't it? Well, we're going to sing a new song right now. It's a song that reminds us that Christ is our hope. He's our hope in life, and He's our hope in death. What is our hope in life and death? Christ alone, Christ alone. What is our only confidence? That our souls to Him belong. What holds our days within His hand? What comes apart from His command? And what will keep us to the end? The love of Christ in which we stand. Oh, sing hallelujah! Our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah! Now and ever we confess Christ, our hope in life and death. What truth can calm the troubled soul? God is good, God is good. Where is His grace and goodness known? In our great Redeemer's blood, who holds our faith when fears arise, who stands above the stormy trial, who sends the waves that bring us nigh unto the shore, the rock of Christ. Oh, sing hallelujah! Our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah! Now and ever we confess Christ, our hope in life and death. Unto the grave, what shall we sing? Christ, He lives! Christ, He lives! And what reward will heaven bring? Everlasting life with Him. There we will rise to meet the Lord. There sin and death will be destroyed. And we will feast in endless joy when Christ is ours forevermore. Oh, sing hallelujah! Our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah! Now and ever we confess Christ, our hope in life and death. Oh, sing hallelujah! Our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah! Now and ever we confess Christ, our hope in life and death. Now and ever we confess Christ, our hope in life and death. Amen.
Well, I'm asking you to take your Bibles now and turn to the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1. A few weeks ago, we started a new series in Mark chapter 1. Had no idea when we started the series what kind of world we would be living in at this time. But you know, there's nothing that catches God by surprise, is there? And so He knew full well, of course, where we would be and what would be going on in our lives at such a time as this. So please take your Bibles again to Mark chapter 1. And we're going to be looking at verses 40 through 45 in Mark chapter 1. If you would, take your Bible and read along there at home with me. Mark 1, beginning in verse 40. Now a leper came to him, that is Jesus, imploring him, kneeling down to him and saying to him, "If you are willing, you can make me clean." Then Jesus, moved with compassion, stretched out his hand and touched him and said to him, "I am willing, be cleansed." As soon as he had spoken, immediately the leprosy left him and he was cleansed. And he strictly warned him and sent him away at once. And he said to him, "See that you say nothing to anyone, but go your way, show yourself to the priest, and offer for your cleansing those things which Moses commanded as a testimony to them." However, he went out and began to proclaim it freely and to spread the matter, so that Jesus could no longer openly enter the city, but was outside in deserted places, and they came to him from every direction. These verses give us a little glimpse into the typical day in the life and ministry of the Lord Jesus. It was a busy day, as every day was for him. As we read here in our text this morning, the few verses that preceded what I read a moment ago, we find that Jesus had been healing people and teaching in the synagogues and encountering all the pressures and that came to him in a normal day of ministry. And on this particular day, Jesus met a man with a hurt that only God could heal. He met a man with the need so great, only God himself could supply it. Now, the first thing I want us to consider is the condition of the man that's the subject of this of our text this morning. Now, Mark gives no details about him, really. We don't know the man's name. We don't know where he was from or what he did for a living. We don't know any of those things about him. Mark simply tells us that he was a leper. That's all we know. But that tells us quite a lot, really. What was it like to be stricken with leprosy 2,000 years ago? Well, let me share with you an excerpt from a commentary I have in my office. It's a commentary by William Hendrickson, his wonderful New Testament commentary on Matthew. And listen to how he describes this dreadful disease, which is still around, by the way. According to medical experts who have studied modern cases of the disease, leprosy usually begins with pain and is followed by numbness as the disease progressively attacks the nervous system. The skin in those areas loses its color, becoming scaly and thick, and eventually turns into open sores. The effects are especially noticeable on the face, where eyebrows and lashes literally fall out, while the skin swells and bunches up, especially around the eyes and ears. The disease also causes those it affects to emit a foul odor, making leprosy repulsive both to the sight and to the smell. Now, to be a leper in the first century was to experience a sort of living death, if you will. In fact, Jewish historian Josephus said a leper, and I will quote, "in no way differing from a corpse." Leprosy was a horrible, debilitating, disfiguring, and deadly disease. Well, leprosy was not only physically disfiguring and debilitating, but it was also socially and emotionally devastating. To be a leper was to be cut off and separated from society. In order to avoid infecting others, lepers were quarantined and isolated from their family, friends, and community. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? They were forbidden to have any physical contact with other people. Let me read to you what the law of Moses has to say about lepers in Leviticus chapter 13 and verses 45 and 46. The Bible says, "As for the leper who has the infection, his clothes shall be torn, and the hair of his head shall be uncovered, and he shall cover his mustache and cry, 'Unclean, unclean.' He shall remain unclean all the days during which he has the infection. He is unclean. He shall live alone. His dwelling shall be outside the camp." Now, according to the Talmud, the closest a leper could come to someone without the disease was, get this, 6 feet. On windy days, the distance was extended to 150 feet. You talk about social distancing. And the fear of leprosy was so strong that when people saw a leper, even from a distance, they would often pick up stones and throw at them to drive them away. It was a terrible thing to be a leper. And that was the condition of the man we read about here who came to Jesus. What a picture of sin this is. Like leprosy, sin disfigures. Genesis 1:27 says that God created man in his own image. We were made in God's image, in his likeness. That's how God formed us. But sin has marred that divine image terribly. The Word of God paints an unflattering picture of mankind. Job says that man's bones are full of sin. David said that man's mouth is deceitful. Solomon said that man's feet are swift to mischief. Isaiah said that man's head is sick and his lips are unclean. Jeremiah said that man's neck is stiff. And over in the New Testament, Mark said that man's eyes are evil and his heart is wicked. Ugly picture, isn't it? Man was made holy in the image of God, but sin changed everything. And then, like leprosy, sin separates. It separated Adam and Eve from God in the Garden of Eden. And it separates you and me from God as well. There can be no fellowship between our sinfulness and God's perfect holiness. And if we die in our sin, we will be separated from God forever. And then thirdly, leprosy's like sin in this way, that sin brings death. The Bible says that the wages of sin is death. And it's a living death of sorts. Apart from Christ, we are spiritually dead in trespasses and sins. Well, thankfully, leprosy is curable today. There are still cases of it. I did a little research, and the CDC, we've heard much about them lately, haven't we? And reports about 150 to 250 cases of leprosy in the United States every year. But leprosy is curable today, praise God. But that wasn't the case in the first century. 2,000 years ago, leprosy was incurable. It was a death sentence, really. And this poor man that came to Jesus knew his only hope to be healed of the deadly disease that was ravaging his body was God. He needed a miracle, so he came to Jesus. Now, the only cure for our spiritual need, that is our sin, is Jesus. Jesus was the only cure for that man's leprosy, and Christ is the only cure for our sin problem. The men have created cures for many different things. We have cures today for polio and tetanus and measles and mumps and whooping cough and smallpox and yellow fever and many other diseases that killed millions of people in the past. We have found cures for some forms of cancer and finding more every day. And as I speak to you this morning, there are some brilliant men, great doctors and scientists who are working feverishly to come up with a vaccine and a cure for those who have stricken with it, and a vaccine to prevent others from getting the coronavirus. And I'm confident they're going to come up with that. But man has never been able to find a cure for sin, and he never will, because the only cure for our sin is faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I want you to notice how this leper came to Jesus. First, he came in reverence and humility. Notice it says in verse 40 that he came to Jesus and he knelt down before him. A posture of complete humility. The leper humbled himself before the Lord Jesus. Reminds us that's the only way to come to Christ. When we come to Christ, we have to humble ourselves before Him and acknowledge that He's the Son of God who died for our sins. And then secondly, we see here that He came in faith. Notice that He said to Jesus, if you are willing, notice, you can make me clean. That's great faith. This man believed Jesus had the power to heal him. That's why he came to the Lord. But here's the thing. He wasn't sure Jesus was willing to do it. I mean, why would Jesus have anything to do with the miserable, disease-ridden outcast like him? I can imagine the devil whispering in his ear, you're not worth saving. There's no hope for you. But it wasn't a matter of whether he was worth being saved or not. And dear ones, it's not a matter of whether we are worthy of being saved or not. We are not worthy. The Lord doesn't save us because we are worthy. He saves us because He is gracious and merciful. Now, can you imagine what a scene it must have been when this poor man, covered with leprous sores, came walking up to Jesus? I can imagine the crowd parted like the waters of the Red Sea. I'm sure many of them moved back in fear and turned away in disgust. No doubt we would have done the same thing. But there's someone standing there in that crowd who didn't turn away. The great physician was on the scene. Jesus never met a disease he couldn't handle. The Bible tells us that Jesus met a blind man and he gave him sight. He met men who couldn't speak, dumb, and he restored their ability to speak, and those who couldn't hear and gave them the ability to hear again. He met crippled men and made their bodies whole again. He even met dead men and gave them life again. And so healing a leper was no big deal for the Son of God. Well, we've considered then the condition of the man. He was a leper in a dreadful state. In a hopeless condition, really, apart from a miracle of God. Now, I want you to see the compassion of the Lord. Verse 41 says that Jesus was moved with compassion. There's an old gospel song that says, no one ever cared for me like Jesus. There's no other friend so kind as He. No one else could take the sin and darkness from me. Oh, how much He cares for me. Don't ever forget that. And Jesus cares for you. He loves you. You say, well, prove it, preacher. I can do that. Just look to the cross. That's all the proof you need. Christ suffered and died on the cross to pay for your sins. And He did that because He loves you. Well, Jesus had compassion on this man. But He didn't just have compassion on him. He did something for him. Notice what He did for the man. In verse 41, it says that Jesus stretched out His hand and touched him. He touched him. Can you imagine what that simple gesture must have meant to that poor man? Remember, he was a leper. He was an untouchable. Now, we don't know how long he'd been in this condition. The Bible doesn't tell us. It's likely he'd been suffering with it for years. And because of his disease, he had been ostracized from society. He'd been cut off from all human contact. He couldn't kiss his children goodnight. He couldn't hold his wife in his arms. He couldn't shake hands with his neighbors. He was a leper, and no one ever touched him. But Jesus did. The Holy Righteous Son of God reached out His hand and touched him. He touched him and made him whole. And Jesus is still touching people, by the way. Every day, every moment of every day, He's still touching hearts and saving souls and changing lives. Well, verse 42 says that as soon as He had spoke, immediately the leprosy departed from him and he was cleansed. Wouldn't you like to have seen that? All the time I'm reading the Bible, I say, man, I wish I was there and I could have seen that with my own two eyes. Well, this is one of those occasions. to have seen this miracle before your eyes. Instantly, every oozing leprous sore on his body was healed. Instantly, his diseased and rotting flesh was made clean and healthy and whole like a newborn baby. Instantly, he was made new. He was born again, if you will. What a picture of our salvation. You see, that's how Jesus saves us. He saves us instantly, in a moment. The Bible tells us of an occasion when Jesus came upon a funeral procession outside the little town of Nain. And it was a sad, sad scene. A poor widow had just lost her only son, and they were carrying him to the tomb to be buried. And Jesus walked up to the lifeless body of that boy, and he said, "Arise." And the Bible says instantly that young man sat up and began to speak. The gospel writers tell us of another occasion when Jesus and his disciples were out in a boat, and a violent storm suddenly swept across the Sea of Galilee. And the disciples thought for sure their small boat was going to sink, and they were going to sink with it. Then Jesus stood up in the boat, and with a voice like thunder, I'm sure, he said, "Peace, be still." And instantly, the wind ceased, and the stormy sea became smooth as glass. After the death of Lazarus, Jesus returned to Bethany and went to the tomb where his dear friend was buried. And the Bible says that Jesus stood there at the door of the tomb and he said, "Lazarus, come forth." And instantly, the stone cold body of Lazarus, who had been dead for 4 days, was filled with life again. And he walked out of the tomb, still wrapped in his burial cloth. Instantly. That's how God works the greatest miracle of all, the salvation of a lost soul. He saves us instantly. Jesus didn't heal this man one ear at a time, one toe at a time, one finger at a time. No, he healed his whole body in one moment in time. And that's how Jesus saves us. The moment we turn from our sin and place our faith in Christ, we are born again. We're made new, new creations in Christ. Instantly we are justified before God, adopted into the family of God, and made citizens of the kingdom of God. Is anybody in this building, I think they'd be shouting about now, but they're not. Maybe you're shouting at home. It's shouting ground. Well, I need to move ahead. We've considered the condition of the man and the compassion of the Lord. Finally, I want you to see the command of the law. Look again at verse 42. I'll read it again. "And as soon as Jesus had spoken, immediately the leprosy left the man, and he was cleansed." Now notice, "And he strictly warned him and sent him away at once. And he said to him, 'See that you say nothing to anyone, but go your way, show yourself to the priest, and offer for your cleansing those things which Moses commanded as a testimony to them.' However, he went out and began to proclaim it freely and to spread the matter. And Jesus commanded the man that he just healed not to tell anyone about it. He said, 'I want you to go to the priest and follow the instructions of Leviticus 14 so that you might be declared clean and received back into the social and religious life of the community.' But the man didn't obey the Lord's command, did he? No, he did just the opposite. He went out and began to proclaim it freely." Now, I can sympathize with him. I can understand why he'd want to do that. It's easy to understand why the man wanted to tell everybody what he knew about Jesus and what Christ had done for him. I mean, it's only natural to want to share good news. And the best news of all is the good news of Jesus. However, we need to obey the Lord in all things. And this man's disobedience may well have prevented some people from hearing the good news of the gospel. It certainly was a hardship for the Savior. And the Bible tells us here in verse 45 that once the word began to spread that Jesus had healed a leper, that crowds began to become so great that he could no longer preach openly in the city and was forced to go out into the countryside. And there were some people that couldn't go there probably. It's interesting, ironic way, really in a kind of a sad way when you think about it. Jesus told this man to keep quiet and tell no one, and instead he told everyone. Jesus commands us to go and tell everyone, and too often, dear ones, we keep quiet and tell no one. We have a great opportunity, I think, in this time to have what we here at church call gospel conversations. Now, those conversations may take place more on the phone or in a text message or however we are communicating today. And it may be a conversation you have with your neighbor in their yard as you're standing in your yard or car to car, whatever it may be. But in these times, these difficult times, people are often asking questions. And we have the answer. And as difficult as this time is for us in many, many ways, it's challenging for the church. It's strange, I must tell you, for Brian and I to be here on Sunday morning with just four or five people. But what a time, what an opportunity we have to share Christ with folks whose foundation's been shaken a bit, perhaps. And we have the answer. We can tell them about Jesus, the one who offers the hope we're all looking for. Well, what a wonderful story this is. I'm often reminded of old songs. I just confess that. Everybody here at First Baptist knows that many things bring a song to mind for me. And there's an old gospel song that says, "There it is no secret what God can do. What he's done for others, he'll do for you." And so I just want to close this morning by reminding you that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And what the Lord Jesus did for that leper 2,000 years ago, well, he can do for you today as well. If you'll come to him as that man came to him, come to him in faith and confess your sin and ask him to be your Lord and Savior. On the authority of God's word, he will save you. He will make you a new person. He will transform your life and give you a hope and a peace that you never thought possible. Well, let's continue now to worship the Lord in song, and then Brother Brian will come and close us our time in prayer. I want to sing a great, great old hymn, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace that brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. The Lord has promised good to me, his word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures.
Here comes the best part.
When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun.
Well, I can't ask you to say amen, so if you would, if you're grateful that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever, would you just push the like button real quick? We are grateful for a God who doesn't change. And as Pastor Bob was preaching, I was just really just focused in on verse 41, that Jesus was moved with compassion and that we serve such a compassionate God. I want to encourage you this morning to discuss the sermon together, to discuss our worship time together as a family or as a couple. Maybe call someone and discuss this together. How did God minister to you? Or maybe some questions that came to your mind. Discuss that as a family throughout the day and throughout the week. Next week, we are going to do something a bit different, a bit special, but it's going to be a little bit different. We are going to virtually do the Lord's Supper together. And so we'll send you a reminder about this, but we want you to be prepared beforehand. So you can be prepared by having some juice with you there at your living room table, and maybe some bread or crackers or Kool-Aid. We don't really care what you use. But we're going to be doing the Lord's Supper in a virtual kind of way next week, just a way to honor the Lord and to just participate in the Lord's Supper. If there's a need that you have, if there's something we can do to help you, please don't hesitate to reach out and ask. Send us a message here on Facebook. Call the church office, 263-5351. Send the church office an email, office@fbcmoberly.org. If we can pray for you, if we can serve you in any way, you just let us know that. Know that we're praying for you and know that we're praying with you. And we'll get through this time, this awkward time. We will be back together in this building soon. Let's pray together and then we'll finish up our service. Father, we are grateful for the day. Thank you for being a God who never, ever changes. Thank you for being a God who is moved with compassion for us. God, we love you. I pray that as we go about our week this week, that you would remind us of your unchanging ways. I pray, God, you would help us to feel your love, to know your love, to feel your compassion. And God, I pray you would help us to live out the gospel, having gospel conversations wherever we are. God, I pray that you would be glorified this week in the life of our church family. We love you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hold me fast. He
Christ will hold me fast. Just in